Am I introducing?
Sure.
Okay. We're very honored to have Craig Bauer from York University. He's going to speak on unsolved ciphers and codes. Thank you,
Craig. Thank you, David. Showing. Thank you for inviting me. It's an honor. So I put codes and or ciphers, or if they're unsolved, who knows, right? Maybe we're misinterpreting it. But I listed editor, I edit Cryptologia, a journal devoted to all aspects of cryptology, not just the mathematics, but also history, culture, pedagogy, author. I used to be annoyed when I'd go to hear a talk and so some guy starts plugging his book. I always got angry because I didn't have a book to plug, right? But now I do, so if you like my style, you might enjoy the book. I brought a few copies with me. And I wrote Ambassador up here. I was lucky enough to spend 11 months as a scholar in residence with NSA's Center for Cryptologic History. That was a huge honor. And I do a lot of talks like this. I greatly enjoy lecturing off my home campus. Okay, so unsolved ciphers. I suspect that there's a large number from the ancient world. Now, this slide will suffice as one example. So this is from Denmark, and it's a stone that's covered in runes, but the experts who study these runes think it's gibberish. And sometimes they even make claims that it was somebody who was illiterate, just imitating writing. Okay, like a child who can't quite write, but just imitates the symbols. That's a lot of work if you're carving them in stone, right? And the Vikings were known to have encryption. They had something like the Caesar shift, where they would shift each of their runes forward one position. They also had something like the Polybius cipher, where you make a little grid.
They had an alphabetical order.
They had three sets of runes, okay? So the runes, it's like dividing our alphabet into consonants and vowels. So they would divide the runes into three sets, and then you can shift direction there. If you just list them as three rows, now you have a little grid, right? And then you can index like a matrix across the top and across the bottom. You can index by row and column. So they could say, you know, position 2, 3, and that would indicate a rune, okay? And it would indicate position 2, 3 by having like a diagonal line and like two lines going off of it in one direction and three in the other. It just looks like an abstract design, but it's actually equivalent to the Greek Polybius cipher. So, I mean, when I think of Vikings, I think of, you know, guys with axes charging at people, you know, covered in blood. But they actually had good cryptography for the era. So almost every culture did. It follows close on the heels of writing. So once when people are barely literate, just writing is a cipher. But once they get beyond that point, there's many people who can read. You need to disguise it further. So I suspect that many of these remains from ancient cultures that, you know, are often taken as just illiterate scribblings are actually ciphers that the anthropologists haven't been able to crack yet. I think we badly need an interdisciplinary effort to get at these. Okay, and like I said, I believe there are just scores and scores of examples. This is one that I pulled off Wikipedia in this case. Okay, the Voynich manuscript. I know David's familiar with this. Are the rest of you? Okay. This is an unsolved cipher that was recently carbon dated as being early 1400s. You know, carbon dating is not going to give an exact, you know, date, but that's when the vellum that this manuscript was written on was created. And analysis of the ink indicates that it was applied shortly thereafter. And the systems in the 1400s, you know, weren't very sophisticated. We ought to be able to break it. But maybe it's a hoax. This thing's actually over 200 pages long. Why would you put such an intense effort into a hoax? Well, King Rudolf II of Bohemia purchased this manuscript for 600 gold ducats. I'm not exactly sure what a ducat is. I mean, I know it's some kind of coin, but it's a gold ducat. And there's 600 of them, right? So that sounds like a pretty good price. I don't feel like I need to translate that into dollars today. If you can fake a 200-page manuscript for 600 gold ducats, that sounds like a good deal. Well, let's take a little look at it. Oh, what is this? It's a page. This is just one of over 200 pages in this manuscript. What does it look like to you? Yeah, flower. Can you even, I mean, look at the top of it. Conjectures to what kind?
Sunflower.
Sunflower, yeah. It's often identified as a sunflower. If you're hesitant to answer, maybe it's because you're looking at the roots. You ever grow potato sunflowers in your garden? Well, there's a whole section of botany. Maybe it's some kind of herbal, saying, you know, what plants are good for what medicines. But the plants really don't exist. They're just mismatched. Botanists can't really identify these. It kind of looks like a sunflower, but not with those roots. If you look at the actual text, we have word spacing preserved. That's not common for manuscripts from the 1400s. A lot of times they would run things together. So it looks like a very simple cipher where you just replace A with R, replace B with X, just a one-for-one substitution throughout the manuscript. And that's what it appears to be. I mean, you have word divisions, and it looks very simple, but a lot of great minds have attacked this problem. William Friedman, NSA has Friedman Auditorium, okay? One of the very best code breakers. He didn't get a solution.
Is he in Latin, or what is the underlying language?
Yeah, that's a problem. We don't know.
If
it was a simple cipher where you just replace one letter with another and you knew the language, anybody could break it. It'd be a piece of cake. And there are techniques to help us identify the language, which I'll get to in my next slide. But it doesn't look like any natural language. That's the problem. So there's some partial nudity. There are a lot of topless women in buckets. We don't really know what that's about. Okay. Okay, so here's some statistics. You can do a computation. I can go into this as much detail as you like. I have a chalkboard here, okay? But you can determine the entropy of a written text. The entropy is the amount of disorder. So when you have a highly redundant language like Hawaiian, by the way, you could have first order entropy, second order, third order. They're converging to the true entropy. They're better and better approximations, although they require more calculation. So third-order entropy for Hawaiian is much lower than any of these other languages. That's because Hawaiian doesn't have nearly as much disorder. It has a small, much smaller alphabet and tremendous redundancy, a lot of structure in Hawaiian. I have a little Hawaiian dictionary I got at a used book sale for like nothing, and I flip through and half the words repeat, like hookah hookah wah wah, right? Just tremendous repetition and redundancy. As opposed to the direction languages evolve in, greater and greater disorder. You know, we have all these rules that Q has to be followed by U. And there's 20-some exceptions, those great Scrabble words like QAT, a kind of bush, right? But then we have words like Iraq that come into our language, or Gaddafi is sometimes spelled QA, right? So as more and more foreign words work their way into a language, more and more exceptions to the rules, the disorder of the language, the randomness of the language increases. So we can do these calculations and measure it. So we call this entropy. This is actually Shannon entropy after Claude Shannon, information entropy. Okay. So if you look, from Chaucer's time, the English of entropy has continuously been increasing. So you can use it to roughly date a manuscript, what century it was written in. And also, this shows that, you know, it's empirical evidence that natural languages, in terms of entropy, follow the second law of thermodynamics. So that's pretty cool. You look at these old languages, Latin and Greek have a relatively low value for entropy. They're much more structured than languages today. Hawaiian, like I said, is obscenely low. And that's what the Voynich manuscript matches. Although it seems unlikely that King Rudolf II of Bohemia bought a manuscript in 1600 or so that was, you know, composed, you know, over 150 years earlier in Hawaiian. I mean, that's kind of a convoluted path. That doesn't seem reasonable. So what we might conclude from this data is that it's not a simple substitution cipher. It's not just A replaced with X or some weird symbol. That is something fundamentally different, something that somehow increased the order. William Friedman's conjecture was that it was an artificial language. And these were popular, I think, more in the 1500s. But you just make up a language like Esperanto, okay? That'll be a very easy language to learn because there are no irregular verbs and it just follows this complete order, okay? So he thought it was maybe an early attempt at an artificial language. So that was Friedman's hypothesis. I think today, perhaps the majority, although there's certainly a lot of controversy, feel that it was a hoax. And there's some statistical evidence in that direction. Interrupt me at any point if there are questions. You know, with a small crowd especially, I don't want to be formal.
There's a guy who blogs about the coinage all the time. I mean,
Nick Pelling?
Yeah.
Okay.
Has he written an article for Cryptologia?
No. If I'm thinking of the right person, he has a book that has some great original ideas. I mean, things that other people haven't thought of. He takes the individual pages, analyzes them, and tries to figure out, they're not bound in the correct order. Okay, there's evidence of this, that things got out of order and rebound. And from looking at the actual vellum and the way that it was cut, tries to figure out the original ordering of the pages. I mean, there's some great work, but there's also material that I would call extremely speculative, just put forth as fact. So, I believe the book's out of print. I tried to get a copy and was not able to. There was a used book dealer selling it for some outrageous price. I was able to get it through the National Cryptologic Museum. So there at least is a copy you can read. But if we're thinking of the same person, I emailed him and didn't get a response. It's very hard to track down this book. But my summary, you've only seen the blog, right?
Yeah.
I imagine they're similar. Okay, now we have a codex from Hungary. It's over 400 pages. And it appears to be some kind of biblical story if the illustrations are not a red herring. And there's a team of Hungarians that claim that they have a decipherment. They're just fine-tuning it. You know, when you break a code, you might have 80% of the code groups, but then there's still the other 20%. It's not an all or nothing proposition. So they're still working on it and are waiting until they have as complete a translation, as complete a paper as they can produce before going public. But sort of the inside word from people that seem reasonable to me is that it looks like they're on the right track, that they are getting it. Many of these ciphers, every cipher I show you just about, has multiple people claiming a decipherment, and they're usually deluding themselves. Okay, the Beale papers. This is one that I'm as certain as I can be that it's a hoax. So I just have one slide for this. But the idea is that there's tons of silver and gold buried, and three ciphers lead to the location of it. One of them tells the story of this gold and silver, and it gives a vague idea of the location. It's in Virginia in Beaufort County, and it was key to the Declaration of Independence. So if you look at a number, that tells you a given word in the Declaration of Independence, and you take the first letter of that word. Okay. But if you apply that key to the other two ciphers, you just get gibberish. So there's a search for what can the appropriate key be for these other two ciphers that actually give the exact location of these tons of gold and silver. Well, evidence that there is no appropriate key is that when you apply the Declaration of Independence to the other two ciphers, one of them isn't really pure gibberish. There are a couple of places where you have almost the entire alphabet. Like it deciphers A, B, C, D, E, F, G, you know, missing a letter or two. Now, if there was really some other document that would provide the key, what's the probability that the one that was used for the first cipher is going to yield that alphabetical sequence twice? It seems like the person who was hoaxing the second two ciphers got bored and started writing the alphabet, you see? And there's other evidence. There are a pair of papers by Lou Crew, the Beale cipher as bamboozlement. So fun papers in Cryptologia where he makes the case for this one being a hoax. Interesting stories connected with this, and even if it's a hoax, it can be entertaining. One fellow proposes that it was a hoax made by Edgar Allan Poe. I personally don't believe that, but it's possible. I mean, Poe certainly did have a sense of humor, right? I mean, not all the time. The Raven's not a good example, but...
But he did write gold one.
Yeah. He had an interest in cryptography. It's a possibility. So, like I said, I don't lean that way, but I'm not immediately completely discounting it. Okay, another example of an unsolved cipher, the Dorabella cipher. This was one that Edward Elgar wrote for a young lady. Elgar is best known as a composer, Pomp and Circumstance, who, you know, we all hear at graduations, one of his compositions. Again, it looks pretty easy. Probably each of these squiggly lines is just representing a letter. Now, even without word spacing, which we don't have here, there are computer programs that could break this in just a matter of seconds. But it doesn't work here. It doesn't yield anything meaningful. Perhaps it's something more complicated. Maybe it's not just replacing one letter with another. I mean, if it were, certainly I would expect it to have been solved. But then again, maybe he uses slang or baby talk or some strange manner of writing that it's not going to work with these programs that use dictionaries of English words to try to obtain the decipherment. So that's a possibility. And here again, there are many people who claim solutions. You can go online and find multiple solutions. But typically the solutions need explanation. It just looks like a random string of words and there's some convoluted explanation as to what Elgar meant by this. So this is one that I have not been satisfied. As an editor, several times a semester I get a solution to one of these famous ciphers that I'll roll through. Others are more obscure. Okay, this is one I like because it's very, very unlikely that this could be a hoax. Okay, this is Joseph Malberg. He is the co-inventor, or you could say rediscoverer, of the only theoretically unbreakable cipher. Claude Shannon proved the one-time pad is the only theoretically unbreakable cipher. And this is, of course, you could have a cipher that with the world's fastest computers using the best known attacks would take a million years to break. That's practically unbreakable, but not theoretically unbreakable, right? The one-time pad is it. This fellow invented it, although we learned recently that it was a rediscovery. It actually goes back to the 1880s. But whether or not he knew of that original discovery of this technique is not known. That is still conjecture. But he's the one that got it into use in America, and it's been popular ever since, although it's not the most convenient system. So he rediscovered, whatever you want to use, co-invented the one-time pad around 1917, 1918. What I'm going to show you is a cipher he created in 1915. And here's how it was discovered. Lou Crewe was looking through some archived materials, and he finds a letter where this fellow is introducing a cipher that Malvern created to challenge officers and others studying cryptography. Now, he brags about this cipher having ease of employment by the enlisted man, extreme simplicity coupled with indecipherability. So, we don't have to look for something very convoluted. He's saying that it's just an incredibly simple system, yet I think it's unbreakable. So you don't have to worry about there being 10 different steps. Now, he wants this posted in the barracks and a limit of 3 months given for its solution. Just one cipher message. It will allow 3 months. And he said he understands that the men don't have a lot of free time. So he's not expecting they could devote, 4 hours a day to this or something. But this challenge. And if nobody can break this, maybe we ought to adopt this system. Maybe this would be a good system for us to use in place of what we presently have. But even more fascinating, he says, if nobody breaks it, the translation should be placed on a bulletin board. So now you have the cipher and its decipherment side by side. And he thinks still nobody can figure out how you went from one to the other. Okay. So if there's any kind of simple relationship between the two, I mean, why wouldn't that be uncovered from having both in front of you? And he brags how simple this system is. See if the officers can develop any method by which translation might be obtained from the cipher given. So, I put this in here for completeness. Okay, you have this in your notes. So this is more than I can read to you in the time allotted. But again, he says it's a simple single letter substitution cipher. You can't be much more explicit than that. One letter is replaced with another. Now, not always the same letter necessarily. He doesn't say that R is always replaced by F. I mean, now, of course, he knew enough crypto to know that that wasn't secure. So there's a way of varying the substitutions, but it's always one letter at a time. As opposed to, we have digraphic substitutions where you replace the letters two at a time or three at a time. A lot of today's ciphers, you replace 64 bits or 128 bits at a time. That translates to 8 or 16 characters. So you encrypt 8 letters at a time or 16 letters at a time. So he's doing it one at a time. It says it can be used by the enlisted man after 5 minutes instruction. And he thinks it's less error prone too. Wow, what possible system can you teach somebody in 5 minutes that would have any degree of security? Here's the cipher. And you can, run whatever analysis you like on this. You have it in front of you. You can go online and download a copy. If you can't find it online, email me and I'll send you the text. You don't have to worry if, if you retype this, you miss one letter and then you're working on a bad data set, right? Now, I have a guess. Bearing all this in mind, that it's replacing one letter at a time, and that it could be taught to an enlisted man in 5 minutes. Here's my guess. This is a cryptographic device that has been invented, reinvented. It was discovered at least 3 times. Thomas Jefferson came up with this idea. You see an old one here. It's not known to be Jefferson's. But what you see is each disk has the entire alphabet running around it. Each letter appears once on each disk. Each disk is scrambled differently. There you see a loose disk, okay? Just to give you a sense of scale, there's a high school student holding one, David Kahn looking approvingly in the background, okay? I worked with the high school cryptography class, and he was one of the best students, so I put this picture in my textbook. But have you seen this device before? This was used in America up into World War II. Okay. So it predated Thomas Jefferson. It's believed that a lot of the Renaissance cryptographers used these. Okay. We don't have a smoking gun, but it's believed that it might have been common in those times. But again, it was rediscovered by Thomas Jefferson and other individuals over the years. But what you do is you want to spell out a message. So you just take your first disk, if you want to say, hello, how are you doing? You find H. And then you turn the second disk until E is lined up with it. You turn the third disk until the L on the third disk is lined up with it. So your message is going to be read across. Hello, how are you doing? And then you have 25 other lines that would represent possible ciphertext. So it's known as a multiplex system. William Friedman coined this term, multiple possible ciphertext. So you have 25 possibilities to choose from. So you form your message going across, you just pick some other line, and that's what you send. The recipient turns all those disks until he sees the ciphertext that you sent him going across. Then he has to look at 25 lines until he finds one that's meaningful. The key would be the order of the disks. The number of disks varies depending on who invented it, but if you have, say, 25 disks, there would be 25 factorial ways to put them on that shaft. That would be the key. That's a big key space. That's bigger than the key space for the data encryption standard, which was used, from mid-1970s up to the 1990s. Still around as triple DES, in a modified form. So a huge key space. A good system. Now, there are attacks. I mean, there are good attacks against it, right? It's not going to withstand modern scrutiny. But I suspect that this is what he's talking about, because how simple is it? You can explain this to somebody in 5 minutes. I mean, I just did, right? And it's replacing one letter with another. Oh, I screwed up a little bit here. When I was first making these slides, I did notice this is U.S. Army. Okay, this is known as the M94. I apologize. I did stick in an extra slide. Okay, there's a Navy version. Has a different name. Okay, so more appropriate. I should dwell on this slide instead. We can break this. If this is a rediscovery of the Jefferson cipher wheel, we can break it. If we know the alphabets, if we know the order of the alphabets. the easiest way to do this would be to just try an ordering of the wheels. If you know the alphabets, try some ordering of the wheels. And it's very unlikely, with 25 disks, 25 factorial possibilities, very unlikely we pick the right one. But we score the result. We look at the results we get. We look at the other 25 lines, and we look for one that's close to English based on statistics. Then we have a lot of E's and T's and not very many Q's and Z's, right? We look for a line that's close to English. So whatever of those 25 lines looks the best, we give that a score based on the text we get. And then we just randomly switch the order of a few disks. And then we score that. If the score is higher, we stick with that change. If the score is lower, we switch back. Okay, so this is an attack known as hill climbing. We just keep making random changes to the order of the disks and continue in directions in which those changes seem to lead to something more like English. So if maybe one of these rearrangements, we get a couple words, or at least letter combinations that seem reasonable, TH, NT, things like this, right? We score it high. So having a computer doing millions of iterations and scoring each and moving in a positive direction in general, we should converge to a solution. Okay. So this is known as hill climbing, and there are all kinds of variants of the hill climbing attack. Ways to improve that technique, there are genetic algorithms. And so some modern attack like that ought to work, and we can solve this cipher from 1915. But to do this, we need to know the order of the alphabets on the disks. So one would hope that there's a document that could disclose this, or perhaps that when we did then move on and start to use the cipher wheel, that it was with the order of alphabets that Malvern suggested. Okay, IRA ciphers. This is a great book. It's a little bit obscure. It was put out by an Irish publisher, so you probably won't see it at your local, you know, corporate bookstore, right? But you can find it online. James Gillibly, he's been described as the best cryptanalyst outside of the government. Okay, so he doesn't work for NSA. So he's a civilian, an outsider to the military, as it were. But he has a long history of breaking unsolved ciphers where the method isn't even known. That's his favorite kind, where we don't even know what technique was used. So a historian was looking at some documents from the 1920s about the IRA, the Irish Republican Army, and they're in cipher. I mean, some of them. He doesn't know what to do, so he contacts the American Cryptogram Association. These fall into the hands of Gillibly, and he breaks them, almost all of them. They were columnar transposition. That means you write your message going across in rows, then you scramble the rows, or you scramble the columns, and then read out the columns. So a pretty simple technique, but the IRA made it more difficult by including columns of nulls, letters that are just random. So if you're trying to rearrange and find a way to get meaningful English, you don't know which column is nulls, you're trying to match those up with other letters to make words, right? So a little twist on columnar transposition. And like I said, he broke most of these ciphers, but a few he couldn't get. So there's some outstanding problems here, and that's a challenge. If Gillibly couldn't get these, you're in for some hard work. And the decipherments are worth the effort. So they're about, you know, procuring explosives and, you know, bombing ships, and it's dramatic. Okay. So it's not like a textbook problem where sometimes you decipher it and it's like, hey, I saw, I conquered. Oh, I haven't heard that one before, right? You know? Or to be or not to be, right? I mean, this is interesting stuff. Okay, now here's an individual. Intriguing background. Okay, you can look over that. Again, you have the handout. Read it at your leisure. But this fellow wrote a book, Codes and Ciphers. In 1939, you know, machine ciphers existed, right? Enigma was around. Enigma was German cipher machine originally intended for industry that the Nazis took and used as one of their military ciphers. So we had cipher machines. We had some complicated systems you wouldn't expect to break with just pencil and paper. But he doesn't talk about those. This book is entirely focused on hand systems, classical cryptology, all of which we ought to be able to break today without much trouble. He included a challenge at the end. Here's his challenge problem, a little challenge to the reader. Well, nobody could break this one. I mean, it shouldn't be too hard. B people went back and asked the author, you know, well, what was this? How did you encipher this? And he couldn't remember. Okay? So he, not even the author could break this. It's so challenging. This is the problem. You cook up some ciphers and, I actually had this problem myself. I cooked up homework problems, just ones I knew were reasonable for my textbook, right? And then the publisher asked me for a complete solution manual. Many of them I had never had to do because I have whatever 25 homework problems in that chapter. Say, do any five. I don't care which five. And you know, I never had to grade more than 10 of them, right? The students would always pick the five easiest, and opinions varied. So there were 15 problems I never had to see, right? So anyway, so I had to do all my own problems. You know, there were a couple I forgot how I did them, and you know, it took some time, but I got through. I didn't run into his problem where he got stymied by his own creation. Probably, I think in many of these unsolved ciphers, mistakes were made. This could be the case in some of these IRA ciphers. I would bet it's the case in this one. He somehow botched the encipherment process. So now when you try to decipher it, the normal approach wouldn't work. There's some error. And I'm not talking just a typo or two, a letter here and there. That's not much of a problem. Leo Marx, he has a reputation as a film director, sort of some cult classics, okay? But he served with the SOE. That was sort of England's version of the OSS during World War II. He served in a cryptographic capacity, and he talked about indecipherables. These are ciphers sent by SOE agents behind enemy lines. They're trying to communicate and say what they're learning about occupied Europe, okay? And so they're risking their lives. They're sending messages. Okay, and meanwhile, the Gestapo is moving around in vans with direction-finding equipment, trying to pinpoint where this transmission is coming from. So every time they go to send a message, they're risking their lives, they're risking a torturous death, and they screw up a little bit on the encipherment, and the guys back home can't read it. So they say, send it again. Okay, and they had a pretty high percentage of these indecipherables. So Leo Marx discusses this in his great book, Between Silk and Cyanide, about how he was able to develop techniques that caused less errors in encipherment, and also techniques on the flip side, that even though the guy screwed it up, we're able to find his error, fix it, and get the meaning of the message. So this saves lives. Less risks have to be taken if the guy can send a message once instead of twice. But it's a big problem. If a mistake is made in encipherment, how do you handle it? Now this got a lot of publicity. The American Cryptogram Association had articles on it in two issues. David Shulman offered prize money, or a book, or some kind of reward anyway, if somebody could solve it. There's some more references. Okay? Now we come to a really intriguing case. Has anybody heard of Somerton Man? Okay. This fellow's found dead in Australia on the beach in 1948. Believed poisoned, although they could not identify the poison. We'll see a couple other poisoning victims in this presentation. So this is post-mortem. No idea who he is. No identification on him. There's a piece of paper that's in a fob pocket in his pants. It's found later. Okay, they didn't do the inquest right away. It was postponed for some reason. So you find this little piece of paper. That's kind of mysterious. Well, it means ended or finished. Okay. So you can imagine he's poisoned and somebody sticks this in his pants pocket, right? It's like a little calling card or something, right? An inside message for somebody else. If this guy was, a Soviet spy or who knows, right? Why would you be carrying this around in a fob pocket? But then again, if somebody stuck it there, why not make it a little easier to find? It could easily have been missed. Now, it came from an edition of the Rubaiyat by part-time mathematician Omar Khayyam, right? Algebraist back in the day, better known for his writing, his non-mathematical writing. But they're able to pinpoint that this came from the end of an edition of the Rubaiyat. Now, interesting theme. The theme of the poems is that one should live life to the full and have no regrets once it's ended. Well, his life has certainly ended. And it's provided a lead when they gave publicity to this. Let people know we found this on the body of the mystery man. Somebody came forth and said, I found a copy of that book in my car one day. That's kind of weird. It's happened to me, actually. One day I got a book in the mail that I never ordered. And the return address was, not really that legible. It could have been Tennessee or Texas. I don't know. Somebody sent me a book randomly, right? The guy finds a book in his car. and it's a valuable book. Okay, so I give the full details here. A first edition of Edward Fitzgerald's translation, 1859, it's by Whitcomb and Toombs in New Zealand. Okay, so he just finds this book, and that piece that was torn out that was in the guy's pocket matched that book. It was from that very copy. Okay, and so this guy comes forth, he wants to remain anonymous, but you know, hey, there's some connection, does this help you? And then this gets sorted. There are all kinds of accusations and denials about that individual and a woman he had a relationship with, and it's just wide speculations, which I don't want to get all into. But you quickly get into tales of espionage or conjectured tales of espionage. Okay. Now, this book that he found in his car, in the back of it contains a cipher. It's kind of short. I mean, generally, longer ciphers are easier to break, but we saw a couple examples, over 200 pages, over 400 pages that we don't have answers to. Here we have something crossed out. What does that mean? Well, down here, it's almost the exact same. M-L-I-A-O is M-L-I-A-B-O, you see? So perhaps he got ahead of himself and encrypted the wrong line. He realized he skipped a line, so he crossed it out, did the line he wanted to, and then came back to the one he was at, right? I mean, hard to tell. Maybe this is a key. These frequencies don't match like normal English. Like we have, you know, too many of some letters. We have a bunch of M's here. We shouldn't have that many M's, right? So kind of intriguing. These could be abbreviations for something. We really don't know. Again, there's widespread speculation. If you go onto YouTube, you can find many videos about this. This is aired on television in various countries. So you can actually have a little entertainment watching those. The Wikipedia entry is also great.